Wait.
Right like the wind.
Woohoo!
Apple earnings. All right, sorry, we're running a couple minutes late. Had a little technical difficulty there, but it's all taken care of now. Iyaz Aktar is in the house. Jenny Josephson in her new office.
Woo!
Iyaz, are you ready?
Yes, I am, and I can read whatever.
You can read?
Whatever, I said. That's a little bit
over. The only word you could read. All right, that's fine. Well, goodbye. Here we go. It's my new beatnik way of starting the show.
When you want to support independent projects and artists and creativity, go to patreon.com. That's patreon.com.
This is the Daily Tech News for Monday, October 20th, 2014. Happy birthday, my brother, Tim Merritt. I'm Tom Merritt. And it's not my birthday, and it's not Iyaz Aktar's birthday either, but he is a senior associate editor at CNET and the GFQ network. Are you a senior associate editor at the GFQ network as well?
You know, I never asked Andrew. I'm sure I could become like senior junior vice president.
You should. You totally should. Co-host on the 404 as well.
True story.
Don't be selling Bacalar and Ariel short either.
I will sell them long.
All right. Let's go long. We got Apple Pay experiences to share with you. We both went out and bought something with it, but let's start off with the headlines. iOS 8.1 came out today. That brings back camera roll, which apparently a lot of you are very excited about. Enables handoffs of text and phone calls to OS X Yosemite and enables Apple Pay. The payment system is set up in the Passbook settings, does not store credit card info, but creates tokens that are used to identify the phone's owner. Near-field communication is then used to transfer the token to a credit card terminal, then conducts the transaction entirely with the bank. This is a little different than how things like Google and Amazon work. Personal information is not stored on the phone. 220,000 locations in the U.S. can now accept Apple Pay. It's not a lot, as well as a bunch of apps as well. We'll talk more about Apple Pay in a bit.
Forget Apple. Let's talk about some Google stuff. Android Police reports that a forthcoming update to the Gmail app in Android 5.0 Lollipop will be able to handle email accounts from other providers like Yahoo and Outlook. Users will be able to swipe the screen between accounts or choose them from a drop-down menu once set up. The accounts will still be separate from the user's Google account, so no forwarding or pop access setup will be necessary.
Yeah, that's kind of cool, actually, because I use Gmail on my Nexus 7, and then I could pipe my Yahoo Mail there, but I don't. I use a Yahoo Mail app, and it's not as nice as having one app pulling in everything. So I would like to be able to use the Gmail app that way. I know I could use it, but there's a bunch of other mail apps you can get for Android, but that's kind of nifty. The Verge's sources confirm a Forbes report that Microsoft will launch its own wearable fitness band within the next few weeks. In fact, sources say it will be stocked in time for sale during the holidays. While it will tell time, the device is more of a fitness tracker than a watch. It'll focus on things like tracking your steps, your heart rate, your calories burned. And it will also supposedly support Windows Phone, iOS, and Android. So cross-platform.
It's like your personal trainer that spots you. They can call it a spot watch or something.
Yeah, wait.
No.
You beat me to the spot watch joke.
No, I apologize. Sorry. GigaOM reports that Spotify has announced a family option plan that offers up to 4 extra accounts at a 50% discount. The accounts are under one billing statement, but each family member gets their own Spotify account, so no more confusing muddling of your listening history, recommendations, and playlists. Existing accounts can be linked under the new plan. Spotify says the new feature will roll out globally over the coming weeks. Family could mean coworkers, roommates, and or chat realmers, right? When you're family, you listen together.
When you listen here, you're family. So let's all chat. You know, I actually have a family plan with Ardio, and the Spotify one is just a slight bit cheaper now. Like a sliver. And my wife's been wanting to move to Spotify anyway, so we may end up moving. This may be the thing that does it. GigaOM also reports Apple reported fourth quarter revenue of $42.1 billion, net income of $8.5 billion. That works out to $1.42 per share, Carl Icahn. The results beat expectations from analysts who were expecting revenue just under $40 billion, and that would have worked out to $1.30 per share. share. 39.27 million iPhones shipped versus 33.8 million a year ago, and that's with the launch of iPhone 6 in there. 13.3 million iPads shipped versus 14.1 million last year. That's not with the new iPads. 5.5 million Macs shipped compared to 4.6 million last year. So a nice little rise there for the Macs.
The BBC reports 40,000 esports fans filled Seoul's World Cup Stadium to watch the 2014 League of Legends World Championship this weekend between the Starhorn Royal Club from China and Samsung White. Thousands more around the world filled up movie theaters to watch the match. For the record, Samsung White beat the Starhorn Royal Club to win $1 million.
That's a lot of money. Man, 40,000 people. I don't think, well, you'll probably get that at the World Series, but it won't be that much more at the World Series this week. It's crazy. Yes. Time now for some news from you. These are things submitted at our subreddit, dailytechnewsshow.reddit.com. We've got lots of folks out there in the audience doing this, so go join them. dailytechnewsshow.reddit.com. Get in there and submit some stuff. Do some voting. Captain Kipper passed along the GigaOhm report that IBM is reportedly paying a company, Global Foundries, $1.5 billion, but not to acquire them. Instead, Global Foundries is getting paid to take over IBM's commercial chip-making unit, which has been losing up to $1.5 million a year. IBM missed sales and profit expectations for the most recent quarter, earning a profit of $3.68 per share, which was 14% below the $4.32 that had been expected.
That's crazy. Okay, Metal Freak submitted the Slashdot post in that OS X Yosemite sends a lot of data back to Apple, and there doesn't seem to be a way to shut it off. A GitHub repository says it provides a corpus of network communications automatically sent to Apple by OS X Yosemite. Among the info sent is when the user selects About This Mac and search terms entered in Safari, no matter what search engine is selected as default. It's unclear if all privacy options were selected in the OS and what the network communication might be used for.
Yeah, and I just saw Molly Wood tweet that there's a Wired story out talking about your Spotlight searches phoning home as well, because they do bring in web searches now. So a lot to figure out about what is actually going on. Usually when we have these phone home stories, it ends up being a lot less data being phoned home and a lot less serious than at first it appears, because everybody kind of goes crazy. But this GitHub repository looks pretty interesting and is worth checking out. Evil Ninja 01 tipped us off to a StopTheCap.com posting claiming South Korea is about to get 10 gigabit per second broadband. It's not quite that good for the South Koreans. Digital Trends reports SK Broadband is set to unveil the service at the 2014 ITU Plenipotentiary Conference today. So they'll be demonstrating 10 gigabit per second internet, but it's not actually launching in South Korea today. The service would be able to transfer 1 gigabyte of data in 0.8 seconds. There's no word when the service will actually be available to customers. And don't forget, Bell Labs showed off 10 gigabits per second over copper wire back in July. South Korea, though, does have an average internet connection speed of 24.6 megabits per second, ahead of number two Hong Kong with 15.7 megabits per second. So it's no wonder that Samsung White won the esports competition. They've got good training grounds.
So fast. I long for this, even half. All right, so Ernie V23 flagged us to a Guardian report that the 12th Doctor has a new mission. Teach children to code. A new Doctor Who... Oh, very funny. A new Doctor Who...
What are you saying about Peter Capaldi?
Easy for me to say. Anyway, like I was saying, poorly, a new Doctor Who online game debuts Wednesday, October 22nd on the CBBC website and includes voice narration by Peter Capaldi, who portrays the current incarnation on television. The free web game is aimed at children 6 to 12 using puzzles based on programming concepts to help the Doctor rebuild a Dalek.
Don't rebuild a Dalek. That's a horrible one. No, it's probably fine. They're just learning the code. It's the eyebrows. And another quick note from Metal Freak. It looks like the Chrome OS devs have changed their mind on EX2-234 support. Networking World reports the team changed its mind and plans to re-enable support in files.app immediately. According to a post in the dev channel, they say, quote, it will come back just like it was before, and we're working to get it into the next stable channel release. So really, actually, one of these, a good example of devs sensibly saying, we want to propose doing this. And then the reaction wasn't unfriendly or hostile. It was just, you know, it was just strong. Like, no, we'd rather you did not do that. Please do not do that. And the devs going, oh, okay, well, then we will not do that. Like, this is actually the way it's all supposed to work right here. It's pretty cool. And that is a look at the headlines. All right, Apple Pay, 220,000 U.S. locations. By the way, there are about 8 million retail locations that take credit cards. This is a very small slice. But McDonald's, Subway, Whole Foods, Chevron, Texaco, Radio Shack, Petco, Panera, if you like your muffins, perhaps you'll use it there. Macy's, and of course, Apple stores. It will work with apps, and in fact, Apple's already starting to spin this of like, most people are going to be using it for apps. That's what it's going to be best for. And it will work with things like Groupon, Hotel Tonight, Lyft, OpenTable, if you're paying for food. Remember, OpenTable lets you pay for your bill through there, through their app. Staples, Target, stuff like that. Also, getting in there with iOS 8.01, as we mentioned, is the iCloud library, camera roll, and continuity. Now, we might want to talk about a little bit of continuity because that's interesting, but Apple Pay is the big one. It's supported by Visa, MasterCard, and American Express. You can use cards from any of those. You can use cards from Bank of America, Capital One, Chase, Citi, and Wells Fargo. Now, that may cause some confusion because if your Visa is not from a bank that supports Apple Pay, the fact that Visa supports it doesn't mean it will automatically be supported. And in fact, if, as I found out, your brand of credit card, Visa, MasterCard, American Express, whatever, is from a bank that supports Apple Pay, but it's a corporate card, it will not be accepted as well. Because one of my cards, they're like, oh, nope, we don't do that. They're not doing corporate cards right now. So not every card you're going to use is going to work. In fact, Ryan Block, I think he said none of his cards in his wallet actually worked, which was pretty crazy. It's also going to be hard for you to find a place in the real world to use this. Walmart's not doing it. They say that it's just they're going to set up their own system because they don't see that many people with high-end iPhones coming into their stores. Starbucks is doing it in the app, but not in the store, which I find a little odd. It was fairly easy to set up. You had to load iOS 8.1. Then you had to go into settings and set it up in the Apple, in the passcode settings. That's how you get it going and start adding your cards there. And then you go out in the real world and you try to find somewhere to use it. Iyaz, where'd you go?
I went to Duane Reade after setting up my card. I also ran into some difficulties setting up the thing because I had a Capital One card and it says use the Capital One wallet app. And so I clicked the button, but I don't have an app. So it just gave me a white screen. It didn't send me to the App Store to go get the app. So I fixed that, took care of that. Took took an enterprising reporter from CNET over to Duane Reade, where we took our phones and we purchased some just random stuff. I bought some pineapple because I like pineapple. Makes me very happy. And so I put my phone to the little machine, and there it goes. It works just like the little ad. There goes the card on your screen. You hold your finger down onto the Touch ID, verify the purchase, and then the weird thing is you want to leave because it says everything's done, but you have to hit the OK button on the point of service machine. But that's it. You're done. It was ridiculously simple.
Yeah, mine was a little bit different. Now, I had one card that wouldn't be recognized at all. It was a corporate card, as I mentioned. Sword and Laser has a card and wouldn't take that one. That's probably good for Veronica. The other thing was I had one card where it wouldn't take the security code off the back. Now, that card is actually fine. I've used it recently for something, so I'm not sure what's up with that. But once I got, I got a card that worked in there, I went out and Whole Foods was the nearest business that took it to me. McDonald's was the second. So that was my backup plan. I'll try it at Whole Foods. If it doesn't work there, I'll go to McDonald's. So I went and I bought 4 oranges and a chocolate bar. Walk up to the counter and I say, well, can I pay with my phone? And she's like, oh, you're the first person to do this. Hold on. So while she's turning around and getting someone else, I see, because I have already got Passbook up, right? I see that it says, would you like to pay with this card? And I say, okay. And it says, press your thumbprint on Touch ID. So I do it, and it says, all right. And then it says, please wait on the terminal. And then she turns around by then, and I'm like, I think it already did something. She's like, oh, I thought maybe you had to tap on it somewhere or something. And then she looks. She's like, oh. And then she presses a button on her side, and it was done. And there were like 3 people gathered around waiting for the bugs or the weirdness or the instructions. Like totally intuitive. I did my part. She did her part. She already knew how to do her part. We were out of there. It took 3 times as long because we were expecting it to go wrong. But if we had not been expecting it to go wrong, it would have been like that.
Yeah. The because of where I'm located in New York, there's like PC Mags in the building, CNET's in the building, ZDNet's in the building. I'm pretty sure this Dwayne Reed probably dealt with like maybe 30 of us trying out this stupid little minimum purchase thing of like, oh, let's buy this, let's buy that. So they were very well prepared for us. They weren't weirded out by the fact we're using our phones. And let's not, I'm sure everyone remembers that Google Wallet's been around for a long time. Tap to Pay has been on credit cards as well for a long time, which also weirds out people if you have a pay pass on your card. So yeah, Apple's not the first, but it worked.
And that's a good point. I've used Google Wallet. My wife uses Google Wallet. And it works well most of the time. But the first time we ever used Google Wallet was not like this. The first time we used Google Wallet, it was sort of like, you have to hold it closer. No, hold it down here. Okay, hold on. You need to log in. Did you not log in on your Google Wallet? Because here's the difference. Google is handling your payment information. Yeah. Apple is not. Makes it a lot simpler. All Apple's doing is saying, we have asked your bank for a token, right? And it's not the same, but it's similar as if you had one of those little one-time or two-factor authentication dongles, right? It's just basically saying, we're asking for a token. We don't want to know who you are. We don't want to know your credit card. We're going to store that in Touch ID. So it's not even stored on your hard drive. We'll never see it. And then when you go to pay, we'll send that token through NFC to the terminal. The terminal will go, oh, that's the token, and send it on to the bank. The bank does all the processing. It makes it simpler, which makes it less bug prone. It also means more privacy. Whereas the Google Wallet has to go, well, we have to make sure that you're the right person, not only with the token, but also because we're going to process it through Google Wallet. We're going to handle the transaction. That also means that Google has to file as a bank. They have to like qualify under federal rules and do all of this kind of regulatory stuff. Apple's saying, for all intents and purposes, we're just turning your phone into a dongle. We're turning it into that tap to pay device.
Yeah, it could be like, I think Discover used to have it. They used to have their pass, little PayPass thing, and they had a little keychain version of it. So just making a device that you already have, it's weird because if you go to the Apple Pay page, you see the devices that are supported for all the things. It's iPhone 6 and 6 Plus. They can do in-app and in-stores. If you want to do that with your iPad Air 2, which would look ridiculous in the store, you're not allowed to do that because there's no NFC. Can't do that with the Mini 3. And then I was looking up about the 5S. You could do this with a 5S as long as you have an Apple Watch.
Yeah.
And a 5C. It seems a little strange that there's, even though it has this extra Touch ID, there must be something different about the hardware, or they're just limiting the availability of this kind of service to see how it goes over time. But it's really limited to people who have iPhone 6 and 6 Plus if you want the in-store thing. That's nifty and everything, but I think this is going to cause a lot of in-app purchases, which means Apple's going to see 30% right there whenever people buy stuff. So they're going to be really freaking happy when we see their next quarter earnings. Oh, look, everybody bought subscriptions or whatever it would be.
Yeah, I mean, I already have one person who works for a credit card company saying that their primary link from Apple to their network spiked approximately 1,600%. People are using this. They are trying it out. But that said, it is a limited number of people in a limited number of locations, relatively speaking, to the number of credit cards that get used worldwide. I think you'd expect a spike on the first day, and this is a pretty big spike, it sounds like. But it also, I got really excited over Square when they did geofencing, and they said, you know, and you could go into the coffee shop in Petaluma, and you would just walk in, you wouldn't have to take the phone out of your pocket. It was even better than Apple Pay because it just said, oh, you're here, you've been here before, they'll recognize your face, and you just say, yeah, I'm Tom. You pay, you know, you could dispute the charge if you needed to. There were security precautions, but when everything worked, it was the easiest thing possible. It didn't catch on because not everybody wanted to use the right thing on the side of the merchant, right, to make that work. Now, this is easier to implement because the terminals are all supposed to be put in anyway that can handle this. It's a matter of whether they want to go with Apple on this. It's easier than setting up Apple Store because Apple's not taking a cut, as far as I know, right? You heard anything different? I think Apple's just...
They get a cut on the transaction fee itself, not necessarily the purchase, like I was thinking with the other purchases.
Right. In other words, the bank says, we process this many Apple Pays, and we collected this much transaction fee from the merchant, and we'll cut you in on that. But they don't get a cut of the purchase that you pay, right?
Right.
So it's coming out of the credit card company, not out of the merchant or the customer. Okay, that makes sense. But this is not going to be good for most people in most parts of the world. The reason Google set up Google Wallet as a funds processor is that gives them more flexibility. It may cause some more bugs in here, but you go to anywhere in Africa and suddenly Apple Pay is just not going to work because most people don't have credit cards. You have to be able to have a credit card to make this work. I mean, that's going to be a problem for a lot of people in the U.S. Alone, not to mention in large parts of the world. So I don't see Apple Pay conquering the world. I see it becoming very common, possibly. But it's, you know, it's, and maybe it popularizes paying with your phone and makes some of these other efforts finally get more traction because of that. But this is not the thing that transforms finances worldwide, for sure.
Yeah, I'm thinking it's probably going to revolutionize, like, sofa purchases. When you're sitting there, you're like, oh, look at that. I just have to push that. Okay, good. I don't even have to get my wallet. My wallet's way on the nightstand. I'm not going to. No.
And that's, you know, and that's what Apple has said. Like, we think apps... In-app purchases are going to be the way. And, you know, it's kind of cool that OpenTable supports it because your app is your way of purchasing in real life with OpenTable. I haven't ever used OpenTable for that. I'm not sure how many restaurants are on board with that. But that could be kind of a secret way for Apple Pay to get into things where the merchant doesn't even have to do anything. They just join some kind of app ecosystem like that, right?
I have yet to use that, but I probably would have that fear of, like, ditching. You know, like, you can buy Apple products in the store with your phone, and people get, like, caught. They're like, you're stealing our stuff. Like, no, I think that fear outweighs the usage for me right now for that kind of stuff.
Like, have you never done that with an Apple store? It's kind of weird to just be walking out, like, without ever talking to anybody.
I don't frequent the stores very often, so, like, maybe I'll try to find an open table restaurant that does it, and then have to explain, like, no, sir, I did not dine in Dash. I used my thumb.
No, well, they know. They can tell if you've paid. It's just like leaving the money on the table, right?
That's true.
Don't really know until they go look, but they get a good idea. It's kind of weird, though. And, well, Uber, paying with Uber, or paying cabs now have apps. You could pay through Apple Pay that way. It's got a lot of different ways to go. I am, though, initially impressed in the ease of use. I don't think that is a predictor of how widely it gets adopted necessarily, but it's definitely got a wow factor. Me and the three grocery store employees that were gathered around were all like, wow, that was amazing. That was easy. You know, like, we were all pretty impressed with it. All right, let's check the calendar real quick. Set your watch, mark your calendars. The One phone from OnePlus will be available for pre-order October 27th for 1 hour only. That hour is 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Please convert to your local time. Interested buyers can prepare their pre-order now via the OnePlus site to give themselves a little leg up, but you must log back in on October 27th in the magic hour to confirm. If this sounds cumbersome, remember this phone was originally going to be invite-only. They've done invite-only sales before. So now they're like, you don't have to be invited in, but you only got 1 hour. Yahoo and Verizon released their earnings reports Tuesday, the 21st. Marissa Meyer is expected to have a lot to say about Yahoo regarding that. Tomorrow is also the GigaOm Structure Connect conference in San Francisco, focused on the Internet of Things and the quantified self. And down the 101 in San Jose, the 21st to the 23rd, is the QuickBooks Connect conference. How about a pick of the day, Iyaz? This one.
I'm like, I don't have one. I think you'll pick one.
I think you'll like this one because it has two things you like, Raspberry Pi and XBMC. It's from Titus James. He says, I know I'm a little late, but I'm just catching up on podcasts. I wouldn't normally dredge up stories mentioned 6 days ago. However, I've been in search of the best home theater PC solution for almost a decade. I've tried and owned everything, Roku, Apple TV, Google TV, Chromecast, and of course, simply hooking up my PC to my TV, which Iyaz and I talked about last week. The best solution, though, came in an unlikely package, the Raspberry Pi with Kodi. Well, it's XBMC, now called Kodi. Obviously, a PC is the best solution, but computers are big, they're loud, they're hot, they're expensive, and when it comes to the UI, it can be a bit clunky. The Raspberry Pi with XBMC, RaspBMC is the official name, gives you all the power and ports you need in an affordable package. I've got a Panasonic Viera smart TV in the house, so I simply hook the Pi to the TV by HDMI and it automatically integrates with the TV remote. It's a little long-winded, but this video goes into all the details and we'll throw that in the show notes as well. It's a YouTube video. This is my first time writing in, but I just had to share the solution because I never hear it mentioned and it's incredibly brilliant. You can run 1080p video with all the features of XBMC, all from an affordable Raspberry Pi that has such a tiny footprint. Hope you find this as interesting as I did. Really, XBMC has some issues with some users, for some users. I've noticed some people just find it hard to set up. But if you're not one of those people, if you looked at XBMC, you're like, yeah, you can do a little configuration, whatever. It's easy. This is the way to go, don't you think?
Yeah, I was clicking the video link. I'm like, is it my long-winded video on how to set this up? Because I did an episode about this in some other past life of mine. But it's a great solution.
I figured you would know how to do this.
Yeah, if you're quite tech savvy and you want to know how to do something like that, it's pretty simple to do if you're willing to take the time. There's a lot of other boxes out there that you can check out that can do similar things, that can handle the same kinds of file formats. XBMC is a great streamer, and it's very good at handling online video as well. But again, it takes a little bit of work. So yep. It's a great point, and it's a great front end, but you probably need a server somewhere in the house still feeding that if you have other content. But good
thank
on
you, Titus James.
That.
Good stuff. Send your picks to feedback@dailytechnewsshow.com. Keep them coming. We love hearing from you. And you can find my picks at dailytechnewsshow.com/picks. Our messages of the day kick off with Glenn Huff and Jason in Stockton, both writing in with a tip for two-factor authentication for those without cell phones. Glenn says, for the non-cell phone crowd, a Google Voice number is treated as a cell number and can both originate and receive SMS texts. For every site other than Google, that could suffice for second factor access by SMS. You've got to have an internet connection for that to work, but it's a good one. If you're on an internet connected computer, you've got a phone number, right? You can use Skype the same way, actually.
You get a Skype out number. I think you have to pay for that, though.
Yeah, Google Voice is free. Skype, you got to pay for it. That's the difference, right? Hey guys, says Christian. A few shows ago, you were discussing why Apple's first 5K display was the iMac, and I think the true reason has finally been revealed. While trying to justify the cost to myself, I discovered that the 5K iMac does not support target display mode, meaning it can't be used as an external display. After posting about this on Google+, I got the following comment. No current cable has enough bandwidth to display 5K at 60 frames per second. Thunderbolt 2 maxes out at 20 gigabytes per second, but of course my calculation doesn't include any overhead, and there isn't much scope for that. That means we need new ports and new cabling to make this work. I guess they could technically use two Thunderbird 2 ports with two cables and divide the screen in two, but yeah, let's just wait till it actually works. Christian says, a little more research led me to this article on Mac Rumors, which backs up the theory that a 5K display requires DisplayPort 1.3 or Thunderbolt 3, which in turn probably won't be available until next year. I think it's likely that Apple will introduce 5K Thunderbolt displays at the same time they refresh the MacBook Pro line with Thunderbolt 3 support. So in short, there's no good way for existing Macs to drive a 5K display, which means the only way to do it right now is to build the display into the computer, which leads us back to the iMac.
Yeah, I was reading that article in my spare time. I was like, this is really cool. What about target mode? What about this? And the idea of cost effectiveness. Actually, it was a Marco Arment post I was reading. That's what it was. And he was comparing his Mac Pro to the iMac and explaining that if he wanted to drive the monitor from Dell, first the monitor costs $2,500, which is the cost of the iMac, and you'd need to have two display ports or two Thunderbolt cables to actually drive it, which would be kind of hackish for it to work because you're splitting the screen and you're hoping it syncs up nicely and neat. But you never know. So this is an oddball move by Apple to go, here's 5K. Why skip the 5? I don't really know, but it makes it impossible to duplicate for now.
Yeah, I bet somebody will come up with a way to hack in and make this thing work. But any hack you're going to do is going to risk stability and reliability, at which point I think the most important thing that Christian's saying here, and I totally agree, is we're going to get that 5K cinema display when Thunderbolt 3 is out. And when Apple finally puts out machines that have Thunderbolt 3, right? That makes perfect sense to me. I got several messages about Netflix and HBO. We've been talking a lot about why is it that HBO in Sweden, HBO Nordic, has not been nearly as popular as Netflix there. They're both available over the internet without a cable subscription. Got an interesting one from Scott here.
Hey, Tom. This is Scott in Hesperia, California. I think I'm a little to your north up here. And the reason why I'm calling is I have a thought on why Netflix might outperform HBO. And being the father of two teenagers right now, I can tell you that neither one of them are interested in HBO. However, they both love watching American Dad, Vampire Diaries, teenage stuff, cartoons. My 5-year-old watches cartoons on Netflix, so three members of my household could care less about regular TV, could care less about HBO, but they all watch Netflix. So anyway, that's a huge market that HBO does not have, and I just think that might be part of the answer. All right, thanks.
And Matthias, who is in the market for HBO Nordic, made the same point. Kids. Basically, all his friends who have kids have Netflix because their kids section is vastly superior to HBO's, according to him. And HBO has a very small kids offering. Matthias also backed up the fact that the technology wasn't working out of the gate with HBO Nordic. The subtitling was bad, and the launch just was muffled in the way that they sold it and the price. Michelle wrote in and said, I'm a paying subscriber of both Viaplay and Netflix and tried a month of HBO Nordic. I think the core of the problem of HBO here in Sweden is the poor user experience. The apps I tried, Xbox 360, Windows, and iOS, felt like they weren't finished. Too many bugs. The most annoying one was the one saying my connection didn't work. Bugs aside, the apps had many annoying things. If you started to watch a new show, it started automatically from the season's last episode. Why would you want to start from the last episode? The app doesn't save the episode if you stopped it in the middle, and the image quality is not good either, or at least not as good as Netflix or Viaplay. The overall user experience is horrible. I don't see any point in paying for it. So there you go. Combination of lots of bugs in the system and not really friendly to the way a cord cutter would want to watch something, combined with kids. Iyaz, you've got a kid. Mm-hmm. They want to watch Netflix or HBO.
So far he's not asked to watch HBO. I did try to watch Game of Thrones once with him in the room, and I was like, nope, bad idea. Yeah. And he's the other thing about this, you have to have consistency, and it's got to be really easy. And if Netflix or whatever service you're using for a kid, I mean, if you think you're impatient as an adult, that kid is crazy impatient. They have no perspective whatsoever. This is the worst thing that's ever happened to them that is buffering. This is literally the worst thing because they've never experienced life. So
yeah.
It better work, or you're going to be dealing with a very unhappy person. So Netflix, my boy.
All right. Well, that is it for this episode of Daily Tech News Show. Thank you, Mr. Iyaz Aktar. Man, it was great having you 2 weeks in a row now. I couldn't be luckier.
Yeah. I was going to say don't get used to this, but try to get used to this. Maybe I'll do this much more often. I just got to figure out better ways to set up audio. But yeah, this is always fun talking with you.
Yeah, good stuff, man. Don't forget our DTNS artist in residence, Len Peralta, has a new comic coming out. If you're interested, you can get all five of the first five pages free at dailytechnewsshow.com. Just scroll on down before Friday's episode. You'll find the post. And it's called Exterminate, about a company that can go into your dreams and exterminate your nightmares. Check it out. Also, don't forget that you're Patreon support is what makes this happen. Or maybe it's your PayPal support that also makes this happen. Or maybe it's your Dogecoin support or your Bitcoin support. I haven't cashed any of those in, but it's good to get them. DailyTechNewsShow.com/donate is the place to go. Right now, we're trying to get to our next Patreon goal so that we can bring Justin Robert Young on as a regular contributor. We're just over two-thirds of the way there. Just over a third of the way there. So if you're thinking about, if you've been thinking, I mean to give Tom $1. That's all I'm asking. A buck a month. Go to patreon.com/acedetect. And if we get, a good 600 of you to do that between now and tomorrow, we'll be able to say, Justin, you're on. So check it out, patreon.com/acedetect. All the ways to help the show are dailytechnewsshow.com/donate. And don't forget about the subreddit, dailytechnewsshow.reddit.com, our email address, feedback@dailytechnewsshow.com, our phone number, 512-59-DAILY, that's 512-593-2459. And you can listen to the show live at mobile.alphageekradio.com, watch the show live at alphageekvideo.com. It even has a Roku app. You can visit our website at dailytechnewsshow.com. Patrick Beja is in tomorrow. He's our regular contributor. See you then.
This podcast is part of the Frog Pants Studios Network. For more information about this and other shows, visit frogpants.com. Audio program so good, it's like you're there.
Done.
Yeah.
Well played.
Dunzo. That was great.
four oranges and a chocolate bar versus, did you buy an actual pineapple? Like a
I bought a cubes of them. And the funny thing is,
oh, like pineapple friend, chunks. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
He bought a Kit Kat and Falcon was like, oh, is that like an apple and Google joke? And we're like, oh, we're so stupid. Should have gotten like a lollipop and an apple because he got Kit Kat. It's like, oh.
I didn't think about it at all. Somebody's like, did you buy apples? I'm like, no, actually I bought oranges, hilariously enough.
Yeah, it's a lot of missed opportunity for real life punnery, I guess.
Well, I guess that's the name of the show, is Apples and Oranges.
Bang Esset right now.
Apples and Oranges.
Everything's taken me a little longer today because it's my first time back in the studio for a week. But so far, everything's working well. I never took this streaming machine to Mavericks even, so it's very stable.
It's always good. When something works, like it stays in a stasis forever for me.
Yeah, until I'm forced. Eventually I'll be forced. I sort of wonder if I'll be forced to actually upgrade the operating system or if I'll just have to buy a new computer because things won't work.
You're like, there's no port for this.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I need Thunderbolt 3.
I had to buy
for my 4K camera.
So to follow up, Iyaz, you can let me know offline if you want, but how often would you like to be on the show?
I got to figure out my Monday schedules.
Today was
we'll definitely talk.
What works. I'll send you an email because we'd love to have you back.
Thank you. I really have fun doing this. I accidentally volunteered to do something, and I was like, oh, right, and there's a video component, and then I have to write something. And it's like, oh, gosh. And they're like, oh, yeah, you're going to test something brand new at the same time. So like, I did not plan my calendars correctly. I have my personal calendar and my work calendar, but I didn't have them both up at the same time. So
mm-hmm.
I'll just get back to that, and then you'll see a how-to for me, Tom, on how to unify your calendars if I do this again.
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be a Monday. I think we were just doing Mondays because it worked well for you. But
yeah,
we can talk
about
it.
I have to find out. All right, cool. I'm gonna go to my desk and try to do some things. And
all right, man.
Talk to you later.
Thanks for being on. It's good having you.
Yeah, great being on. Thank you so much, guys.
Cheers. Go enjoy your pineapple chunks.
So we have a wealth of excellent titles today, of course.
Excellent.
Top vote getter right now is Tom Buys an Orange with Apple Pay, which is really on par with the Daily Tech News Show in terms of title clarity. We have Pineapple Pay, one I really like from Carl, which is Who's Coding?
Right.
Yeah, that's good.
Clever.
Good one. Let's see what else.
Or hose coding.
That's the accent.
Dr. Ho.
Orange
is man. And I hate after a reboot. I have to fill all the ID3 tags out again.
Oh, that's bad.
It's so hard. It's the worst. Oh, first world problem. What else we got?
The one I did like a lot was Orange is the New Chocolate, but I just like that. It's probably a little too inside the show baseball.
Yeah, it took me a second, and I actually made the purchase. So.
Yeah. But I do like a bunch of them.
All right, I'm almost to the point.
I mean, Tom Buys an Orange with Apple Pay is the whole show, so.
That's pretty funny.
It sort of like sounds like the beginning of a children's book. Tom buys an orange with Apple Pay. See Apple Pay go. Go, Apple Pay, go.
No, don't say go.
Oh, right. Wait. Oh, no.
Jane has a Google wallet. She's taking a long time.
Oh, no.
Bobby has PayPal. He can't buy anything.
Poor Bobby. Oh, you're right. Lou says, I liked also Wibbly Wobbly Cody Wody.
That's good, too. Yeah, I'm torn between pineapple pay and Tom buys an orange with him. I actually bought four oranges. You know, the other nice thing, looking at this receipt, there is nothing on here that would identify me. Because, you know, they only show you the last four digits of a credit card anyway on these receipts. And those last four digits are random. Like, they have nothing to do with, they're not actually the last four digits of my credit card. Because it creates a new one-time credit card for every transaction.
You know why that is also awesome? And this is terrible to say, but lots more deductible things if you can't really tell who you are. Like, doesn't that make it harder, like, for your receipts? Like, you could now, like, collect receipts for deductions, and nobody would know.
Well, I actually, it could work the other way, too. Yeah. Like, I could say, like, but this doesn't show that you bought it.
Yeah, that, it's actually, aside from the slightly illegal thing I just suggested, it is going to be a bit of a conundrum, I guess, for the IRS. Although I guess they would, no, it's not. It's, they would just ask you for your, I guess, your Apple
Pay. Okay, but the, aren't the receipts really meant for cash? I'm always confused by this. I'm like, if I've got a credit card statement that says I bought it, doesn't that mean I bought it? Like,
yeah. I don't use receipts anymore. I use them to double check and make sure I didn't miss anything.
Right. I still keep them as a backup to be like, you know, okay, I've got a paper copy essentially. But tax accounting with Jenny and Tom, our new show.
Fascinating. So hey, look at my background in my new office in which I have all of Len's art. I've got DTNS All Stars. I've got my favorite one of all time, which is remember when they did Mark Zuckerberg as the guy from Watchmen? What's his name?
Dr. Manhattan.
Dr. Manhattan. I was going to go with Naked Blue Guy, but I knew
also known as Naked Blue Guy.
It's super exciting. And right now, the office smells like brewing coffee because someone somewhere in the farmer's market.
That is the most beautiful smell ever.
Oh, man. It's like something else. It's all very exciting. I do need more DTNS gear, though, up on these shelves.
We had a store.
If only we had a store.
Well, you have a mug, right?
I have a mug that I have to bring in. I'm bringing in, like, one bit of thing a day. Yes, BioCow is correct. No more husband walking by in the shot in his boxers.
So there's that downside.
Yeah. We have upped the professionalism of the show by 6.8% with that. Although you will occasionally see Katie, editor, walking by in the shop because she is my office mate.
But she is fully clothed, I would assume.
Yes, she's fully clothed.
At most times. What? I don't understand people sometimes. I said, I just don't like the OS. Every time there's an OS 10 update to the look, I never like it. It always looks worse to me than the last one. I've never liked OS 10's look. That's really the issue here. I also don't claim to have any taste, so I assume I'm wrong. But one guy wrote, "So you're a chubby chaser." I'm like,
what?
I don't know what that means.
You don't.
Oh, because I don't like flat. Is that that's what he's reading? Okay. See, I just had to talk it out.
Classy. Oh, cold brew coffee. Oh, man, it just canceled, sadly, my other coffee service. Wow, look at that. It looks like beer.
You have Pez dispensers.
I do. I have Lord of the Rings Pez dispensers. I've got Gandalf, Aragorn, Legolas, Gollum, and then a little Tyrion Lannister, which was Katie's contribution. Very
exciting. I used to have the complete set. Oh, but you know what? They were on the Sword and Laser set. I wonder what happened to them. I don't think they ever made it back of the Lord of the Rings Pez dispensers.
I got the great joke of that particular Christmas was that I got three sets of those from people.
Really?
Katie got one, Matt got one for me, and then I was the jerk who ran out and got it myself because I was afraid no one would get it for me.
Oh, that's funny.
I have so many Lord of the Rings Pez dispensers, it's ridiculous.
That was the Christmas that I bought Eileen Star Wars coffee mugs. because I was at the, I think it was a Walgreens, and I saw the Lord of the Rings things, and I bought them for myself, and I thought, and then I saw the Star Wars coffee mugs, and I was like, oh, I should buy those as Christmas, this surprise Christmas present.
I also have my Star Wars glasses, which are Star Trek glasses, which are coming in over here. I've got Kirk and Spock in the house, and then I'll be bringing in McCoy.
Kirk and Spock in the house tonight.
But see, look here. There's this whole empty shelf area that needs more gear. More gear here.
We should start coming up with ideas for more things.
Interesting.
I am not saying that that's already happening, David Michael. Are you listening?
I'm not saying that I spent some time, you know, setting up something that might or might not help that.
Not at all, because that would be pulling a Johnson.
Mm-hmm. I gotta do better with cords, though. It's too many cords.
Well, you know about Scott Johnson pulling a Johnson.
No, I get the context of it. Like, he says it without saying it, but I don't
basically
know.
Basically, he'll very often say, do pretty much exactly what I did, which is like, I got something to announce, but I can't tell you what it is, but I'm so excited.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's it. He's like, but I can't say anything more. He did it recently. He did it on the most recent episode of The Instance because he's trying to book somebody from Blizzard for The Instance that they're going to record at BlizzCon. And so he was just like, oh, I'm so excited, but I can't tell you who it is. And then he even went the extra step of sending it to Terpster in through Skype without saying anything. And the Terpster going, oh, okay. You know, it's just like torture. I don't even know who it is.
Yeah, that, you know, I love teasing things that are cool that are coming, but I understand people don't always appreciate.
Well, it's one thing to say like a substantive tease and you'll find out more on this day.
Right.
But he's just hilarious for being like actually the Instance thing isn't the best example because he was saying at BlizzCon, we're going to try to get versus like, I've got a thing, but I can't say anything else about it. Like, well, that's not really useful. You're not even telling us the nature of it. Oh, I put that in the wrong place. No, I didn't. Put it in the right place at the right time. I still haven't got this new, I don't hear a phone.
I know, it's buzzing.
Oh, it's at your...
It's on Vibrati. It's Matt. Matt's virtually walking by in his boxers
he's like,
right now.
Stop me from walking by, will you? I'll get in this show one way or another.
I heard that.
What is
heard
he, like
that.
Lucy Ricardo? I'm going to be in your show, Jenny.
Uh-huh. Well, the cool thing is like, A, now... we can have other people on this show in a physical location. If they happen to be in Los Angeles, like they can just be in this spot. And the other cool thing is if we ever want to, we could have a live studio audience. Very exciting.
What do you think the capacity is?
It's actually pretty,
it's not bad.
I mean, you could have like 5 or 6 people here.
Oh, okay.
Max.
No, it's not too bad.
Which would be really cool. It'd really only be worth it if we had like an in-studio guest of some kind. But it's pretty neat.
But then they're going to bring their entourage.
Yes, you know. That's true. There is no green room in this one room. This one room is the everything.
You should just like hang something green in one corner and be like, oh, here's our green
that's
room.
That's the green area.
It's the green corner.
No, we don't have enough furniture yet, so like everything's on the floor. It's like things are on the floor. Oh, you can see my really cool TV bag. It's my bag that looks like a TV. TV bag. Let's see.
All right, I think I did everything right. I feel unsure because we still have that second place with SoundCloud to upload it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, it looks like it's working. When you want to support independent artists.
When you want to support
that. That is what they're hearing on Alpha Geek Radio, but you're not.
Nice.
Okay. We're done. I'm out.
This post.
Thanks, everybody. Happy Tim Merritt's birthday, everyone.
Yay.
He's in Wisconsin. So if you're in Wisconsin, tell him I said happy birthday. Bye. Bye.